What a senior White House official is describing as an attempted act of terrorism in Detroit.
Al-Qaeda claims to be behind a failed attack on a U.S. passenger jet.
Another location mentioned in connection with the suspect is Yemen, where he told investigators he has contacts in Al-Qaeda.
Abdulmutallab reportedly claims he got his explosive device in Yemen, which is rapidly becoming the new battleground against Al-Qaeda.
With the connection to the Fort Hood attacker, he was linked to a cleric in Yemen.
That's where Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula has established its headquarters. This is a concern.
Well, you know, think of this as the post 9/11 Al-Qaeda.
The bottom line, experts say, Al-Qaeda in Yemen may now be able to attack the United States.
Al-Qaeda now has a very strong base in Yemen. Some say it rivals even Pakistan.
Now to the Middle Eastern nation of Yemen, where some 30 Al-Qaeda militants have been said to have been killed in a suspected airstrike.
The U.S. missile strike ordered by the president, which killed dozens of Al-Qaeda militants, an action which officials say was necessary to protect American interests.
Officials said some 35 suspected Al-Qaeda figures had been killed. Opposition groups said dozens of civilians were also killed.
The action represents a major escalation by President Obama in his efforts to go after the terror group in yet another country.
Where Al-Qaeda and its allies attempt to establish a foothold, whether in Somalia or Yemen or elsewhere, they must be confronted
directly from the White House, which now appears very much hands-on in the efforts to decimate Al-Qaeda wherever it is found.
A second attack targeted the site where U.S. officials say an imminent attack against a U.S. asset was being planned.
It's going to cost a lot of money to go after Al-Qaeda right now, but it's going to be a lot cheaper and a lot easier than if you wait until the country collapses.
So if you've been paying attention to terrorism and Al-Qaeda recently, you have likely been paying attention to this poor, largely ungoverned, running out of oil, parched little nation called Yemen. It's rather quietly become, after Iraq and Afghanistan and Pakistan, something akin to America's other war.
Senator McCain and Congresswoman Harman have been in Yemen recently with the attempt to build up Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda, of course, functioning as always as the CIA Arab Islamic Legion. The connection here is that they're trying to build up a presence of Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, a creation wholly of the U.S. intelligence agencies, so that they can play Saudi Arabia against Iran and fight against both. There's a strong current inside Saudi Arabia that would like to break away from the U.S. protectorate.
A husband and wife who are raising a provocative question tonight. Did the suspect possibly have help getting onto this flight? In fact, did this man even have a passport?
I saw two men, and they caught my eye because they seemed to be an odd pair. One was what I would describe as a poor-looking black teenager around 16 or 17, and the other man, age 50-ish, wealthy-looking Indian man, and I was just wondering why they were together. Kind of strange. And I watched them approach what I would call the ticket agent, the final person that checks your boarding pass before you get on the plane. And I could hear the entire conversation. The only person that spoke was the Indian man. And what he said was, this man needs to board the plane, but he doesn't have a passport. And the ticket agent responded, well, if he doesn't have a passport, he can't get on the plane. To which the Indian man responded back, he's from Sudan. We do this all the time.
The fact is that this is a protected patsy. In other words, this is a puppet. This is somebody who's an asset controlled by U.S. intelligence. This is a way to stage a provocation. We've had 4 days of wall-to-wall hysteria worldwide about this.
Everyone has been questioned who was on that flight. Lori, it's tough to understand, I think, especially for a lot of people watching this, and I'm sure for you who were sitting there, how anybody could be allowed on board an international flight without a passport. When you and your husband talked to authorities, when you told them what you saw, what was the reaction?
They seemed really interested in what we had to say. They talked to every family. A lot of the families they were talking to them for about 5 minutes or so. They talked to Kurt and I for probably about 15 minutes, maybe a little bit more.
Let's just look at a couple of facts. His father, a rich Nigerian banker, went to the U.S. Embassy in Nigeria on the 19th of November and said, my son is in Yemen. He's at a terrorist training camp. Do something about this. Nevertheless, the son is allowed to buy a ticket in Ghana, paying cash, $2,800, for a one-way ticket. He can get on the plane in Nigeria after entering Nigeria illegally. And when he gets to Amsterdam, he's apparently, I think, a mental deficient who can't make it from one gate to another. So according to an eyewitness account, there's a well-dressed Indian man who brings him to the gate for the U.S. flight and says, my client here or my friend here doesn't have a passport. Get him on. He's Sudanese and we do this all the time.
However, the FBI and no other authorities have contacted us since then.
And does that seem odd to you, or do you figure that's just part of the investigation?
You know, I don't know. It does seem a little bit odd. If my husband is the only one that noticed this happening, I would think that we would have been contacted for further questioning, especially now with all of the media that's been contacting us.
New excesses of evil is what we've heard all over the weekend and now from Obama today. It's Afghanistan, Pakistan understood as one thing, Somalia, and then Yemen. And I would say in terms of countermeasures, it's time to install a mole detector at the CIA and the FBI and fire the head of Homeland Security, Janet Napolitano, Incompetano, Totalitariano, who doesn't even know her own failure when she sees it, looking at it in the face. We can't know whether these people are complicit or whether they're just incompetent, but they should be fired.
Well, thank you.
Aggressive in here and state that Yemen government didn't have any option but to ask Saudi Arabia for military help. This distortion of the truth and trying, it's playing in what we call the Western agenda in here, of criminalizing Iran. I blame Al-Quds Al-Arabi for running such a story without it checking its sources, because there is no truth in this story to start with. The other issue in here, this is a continuation of the Obama sort of policy, which is take on from where George Bush left as what they call it, the chaos in the Middle East, create the bigger Middle East, shaking the whole Middle East, helping and creating a new entities and creating more wars.
Sana'a specialized penal court held its first session on Saturday. Three locals stood trial on forming a terrorist group charge and working for the Israeli's Mossad intelligence agency. The concerned judge said that the three persons were accused of spying for Israel through communication with the office of Israeli outgoing Prime Minister Ehud Olmert. During the correspondence, the network asked for help to carry out terrorist activities inside Yemen.
Yet we're funneling a load of military aid to Yemen. Last year we didn't at all. So that really underscores how important Yemen is. If Yemen falls, that could be the new battleground for al-Qaeda.
Absolutely, and of course that's along key tanker routes for the Red Sea. If Yemen falls, I mean the price of oil immediately goes up, and some 24 million people fall under the sway of al-Qaeda and radical militants linked to Iran.
Meanwhile, there is also news tonight out of Iran. You remember that on Monday, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton said the new administration's engagement with Iran has not been productive.
Russians caution that there is no proof the Iranians are trying to build nuclear weapons, but the Israelis are not convinced. And new details are emerging about the Air Force drill they recently conducted, designed to send a message to Tehran.
Israeli warplanes have conducted what U.S. intelligence analysts say was a dress rehearsal for a strike against Iran's nuclear facilities. Ominous action backed up by ominous words from Israel's ambassador to the U.S.
We cannot take this threat lightly. And as our Prime Minister just recently said, Israel will not tolerate a nuclear Iran.
It's sort of operating near their border from Yemen. Are they waging, the Saudis, a proxy war with Iran? And to some extent, would they be happy to see Israel take action against the nuclear weapons apparatus of Iran?
There's Israel now warning that Iran is on the verge of being able to create a nuclear weapon.
You say the window for diplomatic action is closing. How much time is there?
Less today than we had yesterday, and it's running out.
For many countries, choosing between bombing Iran and Iran with a bomb is a tough call, but there's no doubt what choice Israel would make.